Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. I'm Juliana and today I'm going to give you a book review that is old since last year. This was supposed to be my September book for the challenge 12 books for 2023, but you know, for this and for that and so on and so forth, it never came to be in September, so I'm here now bringing you the book review. And the book that I'm going to talk about is Memoirs of Hadrian by Marguerite Yourcenar. So I'm going to structure this video a bit by the preface that is present in this Portuguese edition, because this work is very singular. I think I already mentioned it, that I thought that this was non-fiction, that this was a kind of autobiography by the Emperor Hadrian himself. I never thought that this work was fiction. Just, I don't know, maybe a year ago or so was when I discovered that this book was a fictionalized letter by the Emperor Hadrian to Marcus Aurelius, his successor. So, all imagined by Marguerite, of course. But I thought, as Marcus Aurelius has meditations, so it is his own reflections on life that I already have read. Also, I thought this was similar, but no, this is fiction, and I'm going to try to make a bit of a context. So, a contextualization of the work, a bit about the author's life and also about the work in itself, this novel in itself. So, let's begin. I have my notes, so please excuse me if I look at my computer, because I want to give you a more structured video this time, not just me rambling about my thoughts, because this particular work, for me, it was quite complex and I think it deserves a bit more of history behind it. So bear with me, okay? So Marguerite Yourcenar was born in Brussels, Belgium, in 1903. Her father belonged to a family of a French upper bourgeoisie. How do you say it? Upper bourgeoisie. And her mother was a representative of the Belgian aristocracy. But, well, it happened a tragedy because her mother passed away after 10 days of the birth of Marguerite. So Marguerite was raised in her paternal grandmother's house. She was educated at home and with many preceptors, and she learned Latin and Greek from an early age. So she contacted with ancient languages since she was a child. In 1924, Marguerite, then with 21 years old, visited Hadrian's villa with her father. Being that Marguerite was a connoisseur of classic literature and an appreciative of Greco-Roman art, this trip with her father would have a profound impact on Marguerite and shape her future literary choices. So that is basically the context of this novel. She then conceived her first writing project between 1924 and 1929, in which she wrote several versions of a narrative which the main character is Antonio. I don't know how well to pronounce it in English, but Antino was a lover of, we suppose, of course, a lover of Hadrian. He had a few along his life, but this one was one that had a great impact on Hadrian's life. And Antino also had a tragic ending, and it hurt a lot Hadrian, and he ordered for statues to be built for all the Roman Empire. Marguerite, at the beginning, as I was explaining, she wrote this manuscript in Antino's perspective, but this manuscript was rejected by the editor and therefore destroyed by Marguerite. Only after 5 years did she gain courage to return to the project, with the theme being revived and abandoned several times between 1934 and 1937. But in this new version, Hadrian becomes the central focus and Antino becomes secondary. So she shifts the perspective of the characters, or the focus character of her novel, and she makes Hadrian the central focus. In 1939, with the beginning of the Second World War, Marguerite moved to the United States, leaving the manuscript and the majority of her notes in Europe. Between 1939 and 1948, the project was abandoned again. But the continuous search for places and works of art through which she maintained contact with the character never let her forget the project for once and for all. So because she was so knowledgeable about this time in history, because of her upbringing, and also because she was collector of pieces of art, and she was a researcher also in her own way, for personal reasons, I think, but, or for a personal gain, but she was, and this never let her forget the project, you know, forever. So that's why we have this work published right now. Finally, a suitcase with documents is sent to her from Switzerland, and it was a conjunction of letters of her family and so on, but in the middle of that she unfolds a yellowed sheet that reads, "My dear Marcus," and it was, you know, the manuscript that she had abandoned in Europe. Marguerite claims that she tried to read you from the inside what 19th century archaeologists did from the outside. She wrote uninterruptedly for 3 years in a style entirely foreign to the literary currents that emerged in the 1950s. So, doing the math, 27 years separate the first project sketched in 1924 and the final publication in 1951. The author herself presents the book as a work of maturity and slow maturation. The fact that she has a classical background with knowledge of several ancient and modern languages was a fundamental aspect for her research work. So something that is explained to us in this preface, this is by Isabella Alçada. So, of course, this is my Portuguese edition, so it will be different in your country, in your edition from your own country, or the editions that are available in your country. But it was tremendous help for me, this preface. And also, at the end of the novel, it has notes about Memoirs of Hadrian, written by by Marguerite Yourcenar. So she explains in her own words how her process came to be and how this long turn of events that make part of the life of this work by her came to be. So that was a tremendous help as well. But what I did was, I read the preface, I read Memoirs of Hadrian, I read the notes of the author, and then I came back and read the preface again. And that was a tremendous help for me to structure my ideas of the novel in my mind. And there's a book in here that is mentioned, Les yeux ouverts. This is the title in French, and that is a collection of interviews done by Matthieu Galey, or Matthieu Galey, I don't know how well to pronounce it, I'm so sorry, published in 1980. That the title in English is With Open Eyes, Conversations with Matthieu Galey. If I discover a cover for this book, because it's kind of old, and in Goodreads what I found doesn't have a cover, so I don't know if I'm researching it wrong or what is going on, but if I discover a book cover, I will let you, I will put it here or here for you to see, and I will also write the title down below in the box description. And now I'm eyeing on this book to read it, because I became very interested in the process of research and the steps that Marguerite Yourcenar took to write Memoirs of Hadrian. And that is what this collection of interviews is about, is Marguerite Yourcenar writing process. So, talking a bit about what's the main focus of this work. So, this takes the form of a long letter that Hadrian, the Roman emperor, feeling the proximity of death, addressed to his successor, Marcus Aurelius, that then was 17 years old, with the intention of contributing to his formation, to his education as a future emperor. This is the sharing of an autobiographical testimony, a political and moral testament, reflections on the circumstances that define Hadrian's life. Although the narrative is not completely linear, the structure of the work is clear. So this is organized into 6 chapters corresponding to the different stages of life of Hadrian's life. The titles of these chapters are in Latin, and that symbolizes the situation in which the narrator sees himself, so Hadrian.
So the first chapter is Animula Vagula Blandula. So little soul, tender and floating. That is a verse that appears in the poem written by Hadrian, engraved in his epitaph. It opens a kind of prologue in which he presents himself in the final phase of his life and states the reasons that justify the decision to write the letter. The second chapter, Various Multiplex Multiformes. So, varied, multiple, multiform, suggests his multifaceted character, in constant search for knowledge from childhood to his rise to power. Then we have the third, Telos Stabilita, so stabilized earth. The fourth chapter, Saeculum Aureum, golden century. The fifth chapter, Augustan Disciplina, Augusta Discipline. The sixth chapter and last one, Paciencia. Patience. I'm sorry. So, 3 to 6 are currencies that appear on coins, minted at the time, chosen to define the central feature of the periods in which his destiny as emperor became aligned with the destiny of the empire. So, Hadrian was born in the Iberian Peninsula, in Italica, and from an early age he was very curious and very thirst with a very thirst for knowledge. So he was interested in all areas of knowledge. He was orphaned at the age of 12 and he received two tutors, Trajan, his cousin, whom he will succeed, and Atiano, the friend who takes charge of his education and will serve him faithfully as an advisor. Also, he has the friendship of Plotina, the wife of Trajan, the emperor, and she will prove to be one of his greatest friends and influences on his political destiny. It was through her that Hadrian could reach some functions within the closest circle of Trajan, like writing his speeches and so on. It was because of her, and so little by little Trajan would trust Hadrian with those kinds of tasks, and between Hadrian and Plotina, they would have long talks and conversations about everything, and that part of that friendship is really explored in this work. When Hadrian succeeds Trajan in the third chapter, we see Hadrian in his policy of peace and reforms. He approves laws to improve the situation of women, allowing them to inherit and manage family assets and not marry without their consent. He improves the condition of slaves by prohibiting them from being forced into degrading work and from being sold without taking into account family ties. And so many other things that Hadrian did when he was in power. Hadrian was also an emperor known to not stay in Rome for too long. So in 20 years of government, he spent 12 of them traveling. So his politics was about proximity to maintain peace. During this long letter that Hadrian is writing to Marcus Aurelius, he will talk about politics, as you may understand by now. He will talk about his relationships with different people, like Plotina, as I said. He will give his perspective on ways of life, meaning like the things that I said before, like reforms that he thought were useful and pertinent to the empire. And something that Hadrian will also talk about, his favorites, meaning men that he knew and became points of interest in a point in time during Hadrian's life. Because before Marcus Aurelius became the wanted successor of Hadrian, he had others. But for some reason or another, and tragic circumstances, those men would end up dying, and every single time Hadrian would, you know, be hurt. And he even talks about here a favorite that he had, not that he made him his successor, but you know, he was his lover, but that type of relationship ended, but he maintained friendship with this man, and he would maintain him in his circle of proximity. So stuff like that. So in here you will find, as I see it, this is interpretation of Marguerite Yourcenar about the personality of Hadrian, about her extensive research of documents and biographies and also archaeological works. So she was tremendous in her research about information of this Roman emperor. And this is her interpretation of how Hadrian would rationalize, would speak, would converse with people. In this case, in the form of a letter. You will become to appreciate this work for the writing, because the way that Marguerite took Hadrian's perspective and put it into words is magnificent. So I'm speaking for my own experience. I'm not knowledgeable about the Roman history. Now I want to be, of course, but I'm not. And I didn't have any baggage of knowledge, not any at all, but I knew he existed, but at least. Not because I have read biographies or read works of history about the Roman Empire, not anything like that. So I came to this work, to this novel, like blind. So this for me was more a reading experience for the writing in itself, and only for the writing, then the informations that you will end up encountering here. Of course, if you are knowledgeable about the chronology of Hadrian's life and Hadrian's doings during his reign, you will encounter historical events during your reading. Of course, one or so I knew about, so that was curious to me, like, oh yes, that happened. So stuff like that. But now I want to be, and I want to read everything that there is to know about the Roman Empire. I'm very curious about it. And this is why reading is so fun, right?
one book leads you to another that leads you to another, and that's a chain that never ends. So I really advise you to pick this one up. I want to be more enthusiastic about it because I don't think I'm being that, but this is a book to savor, you know, because this is a man in his dying bed reflecting upon his life, trying to bring some knowledge to a young person and passing all that he can so that young person can be a good emperor as he was, you know. So the writing is superb and it's wonderful. It's, it can be a bit dense in some parts, at least for me it was. For you perhaps it won't be, so who knows. But in the best way possible. I'm saying this, but in all positive perspective, because the talent of Marguerite is so unbelievable, even. So, yes, this was a wonderful reading experience, and I'm really glad to have done this and to have read it. Now I'm passing you this book, and it's your turn to tell me what you thought, if you have baggage about the Roman Empire, and if you think that this is more or less accurate. I'm trying to acquire soon the book that I told you, that is called With Open Eyes, Conversations with Matthieu, Galey. And if I acquire it, I will bring a conversation about that book if I think it has any relevance to add to this one. So yeah, that's it. Please subscribe to my channel if you haven't subscribed already. Don't forget to press the ring bell button to all so you can receive all my notifications. Leave a like, it helps out the divulgation of the video and the divulgation of the channel. Follow me on Instagram and on TikTok and on Pinterest and on Twitter. All of them. There are many, right? But yeah, if you want to, of course. And yeah, I will see you on the next one.